with me if you know this song. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Let's do it one more time for those of you who maybe didn't remember, but now you know. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. I just want to invite you to raise your hands and just to prepare yourself to hear from him today. I want you to do that by thanking him. Just thank him. Be specific. Thank him for the things he's done for you. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to leave my mic on and you'll hear my thanks. I have very specific things, but I want you to do that. And don't worry, we're kind of spread out. You can thank him as loud or as quietly as you want. But God, I am so grateful for everything you've done in my life. I'm so grateful for the redemption you've brought in my marriage, through my marriage journey. I'm so thankful for my dad and his health, and the fact that you got him into that surgery quickly when he just needed it. I'm so grateful, God, for your protection over my great nephew who was born too early and who is thriving because of your grace and mercy. I'm so thankful for my family, God, for your goodness to us through our generations. Thank you, God, that you are a good God. You are a kind God and a loving God. And I know that you're good, and I expect more good from you, God. I stand in expectant waiting from you, God. So I just thank you, God. I thank you, God. God, prepare our hearts to hear from you today. Make us ready to hear from you, God. This isn't me speaking. This is you. This is your word. I just pray, God, that your word today would land on tender hearts that are ready and open and ready to hear your word and to act on it, God. Yeah. Thank you for your goodness. All right. I'm supposed to only preach for 25 minutes, so I'm going to give that a try. My title today is Encountered. Because last time I didn't have a title, and I had to think of one later on, so I came up with one this time. At a recent equipping time, we were learning about healing and miracles. And one of the speakers that we listened to said this statement. He said, when others meet us, they encounter Jesus.
Yep.
Now, what a simple statement, but man, that has stuck with me, and it has made me ponder, what does that mean? The world doesn't know who Jesus is unless they meet someone who knows him. Of all the other things that were spoken, that stuck out, and I have been really pondering this, so that's what I'm going to be talking about today. I started thinking of this from the other person's perspective. So if someone meets me, and they're encountering Jesus, what exactly are they seeing in me? Okay, and then my next question was, so what do I need to work on to become more like Jesus, like Christ? Does anybody here hear a problem with that question? Do you hear how it's centered on me?
Right.
What do I need to do? What do I need to be to become more like him? What do I need to do? So I started to have a little bit of a panic because it's impossible. It's impossible, it seems to be. And yet, John 1:12 clearly says that our relationship with God is a result of his work, not ours.
Amen.
So I'm going to read that scripture to you. It says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he handed it over, the right to become children of God.
Right.
Children born not of natural descent, nor of a human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. He does the giving, right?
Hmm.
So the inward work of the Holy Spirit, the work that happens inside us, affects our outward acts. So we respond, we act. There are things that we do. But as a transformed Christ-believing Christian, it's that Holy Spirit work inside that affects how I act.
Right.
So that's what we're going to talk about today. The Holy Spirit acts, we respond. So for example, every time Jesus was moved with compassion, so that's the Holy Spirit working in his inner man, Every time he was moved with compassion, he performed a miracle for someone.
Yeah.
He never failed. His response was to the work of the Holy Spirit.
Good.
Yeah.
So, how do others encounter Christ and they encounter me? So that word encounter can mean to contact, to touch upon, to meet, to experience, to just bump into. And so we touch lots of lives simply by bumping into people. We bump into people at the grocery store, we bump into people, even when we're driving down the road and something happens, they see our response in our vehicle, right? We're bumping, I don't mean don't bump into people in your cars, that's what I'm saying. But we bump into people and it's a short-term thing. But even then, they should be encountering Jesus in us, the living hope, even then. We touch other lives more deeply when God places us in purposeful community with each other. So that could be a church community like this. And hi to those of you who are online. That includes our online group. In a neighborhood, maybe, your neighbors, in a work situation, in a friendship circle, of course with your family and your spouse and your kids. And each of those encounters is a reflection of Christ in us, the hope of glory. And the way that people witness Christ in us is through our response to the Holy Spirit's work in us. So our actions are the outworking of his work. Is that making sense so far? So I want to talk about the characteristics of Christ in us. And this is not an extensive list by any stretch of the imagination, but I'm going to talk about 8 different characteristics that people should see in us, even in just a bumping into us kind of a situation. All right, first I want you, we're going to turn to lots of scriptures to get your Bibles ready. Okay, I want you to first turn to Colossians 1, 27. It's Colossians 1, 27. Because I'm going to talk about Christ in us, the hope of glory. And I'm not making up that phrase, that comes from the scripture. So Colossians 1, 27. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Isn't that beautiful? It's a spiritual mystery. That God will reveal that mystery to us as we respond to him. All right, so I said there's going to be 8 characteristics. We're going to go through them, and I'm going to show you what people should encounter when they encounter us. And then I'm actually going to show you how that is even possible, because this is actually quite the list of how we should be behaving towards others or acting towards others. Okay, first of all, God wants us to be humble. We will be humble. So I want you to turn to Philippians 2. Now we're going to be in Philippians again later, but if you turn to Philippians 2, page here, there we go, and verse 1. This is a very, very familiar scripture. You guys will recognize it right away if you've been a Christian for any length of time. In verse 1 it says, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, having him work inwardly in you. If any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit, and in one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. So this speaks to humility. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And then it goes on, you can read this in your own time later, but it goes on to talk about how Christ, even though he was equal with God, did not, how did they word it? He did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, but rather he humbled himself, even to death on a cross, to redeem those and bring them into that mystery of relationship with him. So our first thing that people are going to notice about us is we're going to be humble people. It's a tricky one, eh? Arrogance has no place.
Yeah.
right, our second thing we're going to go on to is that we are going to be grace-filled and graceful. So I want you to turn now to 1 Timothy. Keep your finger in Philippians, because remember, I promised we're going to come back there. But just pop over to 1 Timothy, chapter 1. And my Bible has a heading that says the Lord's grace to Paul, right there, verse 12. So our experience of grace, the gracious saving power of our Redeemer Christ, makes us act in grace towards others. The scripture says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Almost sounds like there's a bit of arrogance there, doesn't it? Until you read the next verse. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy. Because I acted in ignorance and unbelief, the grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and the love that are in Christ Jesus. So that pouring out was the work of the Holy Spirit. Pouring out, a free gift. Even, and you can plug in your own past sins there, even though he was a persecutor, a blasphemer, a violent man, that grace was given freely. And then Paul went on to work with all of this verve and energy. That was his response to that grace and that mercy. Here's a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. And then Paul bursts into praise, spontaneous praise, because wow, isn't God good? Isn't God good? All right, so far we're supposed to be humble when people bump into us, grace-filled, and we act in a graceful way to other people as well. Now the next six characteristics are coming from Philippians 4. So pop back to Philippians again. And now you don't have to jump around very much, because this passage is full of some practical stuff. Our next thing is that we're going to start in chapter 4, verse 4. And we're going to go verse by verse. Verse 4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. So we are supposed to be, this is our next thing, thankful and joyful. And you see how I'm doubling up some of these, just to sneak in some extra points there. Thankful and joyful. It says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. And I think he says that twice to emphasize how important this is and maybe how hard it is for us too, right? We need to celebrate him. We need to display outrageous gratitude to him. We need to testify of his abundant goodness so that, in Psalm 145, Derek read part of it today. I don't know if you read this verse, but in that same psalm it says, all people, we say these things, we testify, we worship him, we praise him, we testify to his goodness, because all people will know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom here on earth and in the kingdom to come. So we do this through worship, through praise, through testimony. And this is not just for now, this is for the kingdom to come as well, which is pretty exciting to be involved in that. All right, so far, this is what people are saying, just bumping into us, encountering us. Humble, grace-filled and graceful, thankful and joyful. All right, the next one's one of my favorites. Let your gentleness, verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all, the Lord is near. Now, isn't that fascinating? That gentleness would be one of the key elements that shows you that God is near. That's God in us, right? I find that completely fascinating. Do you remember a while back when Teresa spoke about shepherds? She was speaking of Psalm 23, and she used an illustration of a tour bus in Israel and how the tour bus driver was explaining what a shepherd does and how he takes care of the sheep and guides them and leads them. And then out the window, they saw this guy with a big stick, and he was hitting the sheep and pushing them and forcing them along. And so the bus driver got out and actually went and talked to him and said, you're a shepherd, why are you doing this? Why are you beating the sheep? Right. And the man looked at him and said, but I'm not a shepherd, I'm the butcher.
Yeah.
Now that's the difference between right. That gentleness of the Holy Spirit's leading and that pushing
right. Yeah.
Of a butcher.
Yeah.
So we need to be shepherds, not butchers.
Good.
All right, let's go on to the next verse. So far, I got to recap because I'm a teacher. That's what I do. We need to be humble, grace-filled and graceful, thankful and joyful and gentle. All right, you're starting to feel a little bit of, wow, this is hard stuff. The next thing is prayerful. So if we go on to verse 6, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Now, there are going to be things in life that we are anxious about, that we have the potential to be anxious about. But we serve a God who goes against those natural tendencies in us. We can go to him. That word petition means we have every right to go and ask him. Ask him for help. Ask him for provision. We take our requests to him. And there's a rest and a peace that comes in that, in knowing that our God has everything in control and that he is our Father and he is a good, good Father. So you're feeling anxious? Do not do what the world tells you to do. Don't spread fear. Don't spread your anxiety. Don't go to someone to tell them how anxious you are and expect them to commiserate with you and build that up.
Yeah.
Take it to God. Say, God, this is what's bothering me. Bring your peace. I need your peace. I need to know, I need what the world cannot give me. So Christ's peace, that's our next step. To keep reading. In verse 7, if I'm tracking here, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Such a good scripture, such a hard one, isn't it? But that Christ's peace should supersede every situation in our life. Not just some situations, every situation. And I'm not saying that I do this perfectly. This is something that is hard won. Because you have to keep going back to God with thanksgiving, petition, prayer. Bring your peace, God. Bring your peace, God. And that should be something to people seeing you. This is countercultural. People recognize peace when they see it because there's none around them.
Yeah.
We live in chaotic times. And so they recognize peace.
Right.
They're going to see it in me.
Yeah.
All right, let's keep going. So, recap. Humble, grace-filled and graceful, thankful, joyful, gentle, prayerful, peace-filled and peaceful, because that's going to make us act in peace towards others. All right, the next one's getting a little bit harder, too. A little bit closer to home now. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. People will recognize in us a purity of thought and mind. This is really hard in a world where images and news and information is coming at you at such great speed.
Yeah.
So that purity of mind, how would somebody see that in me? If I'm filling my mind with pure stuff, they're going to hear it when I speak. They're going to see it in my actions. They're going to see it in my attitude. They're going to see it in my worldview. Do you know your mind? Your purity of mind affects your worldview and what you believe.
Yeah.
And how you take in information and how you recognize truth from non-truth.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So feed your mind on purity, on pure things. And the Holy Spirit will always cause us to clean out the impure because he's a God of purity and truth. All right, so far this is getting to be a long list, and this is not exhaustive, but here's our last one. Worthy of being imitated by others. So we're going to verse 9. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. When we align ourselves with God, with his Holy Spirit working within our inner man, we can boldly say to others, imitate me. That's going to take some thinking. I'm going to have to ponder on that one now. We can boldly exhort others to follow us when we're rightly aligned with him. And the beauty of this is that the wisdom that we help people to live out life well is not from us. It's not about us. It's about being aligned with him and being able to guide others because he's done a work in us. And we're just responding. Just mark down this scripture, but in Deuteronomy 4, verses 5 to 9, there's a really neat scripture in Deuteronomy about when God originally gave his laws and decrees to the Israelite people. And it says, "See, I've taught you the decrees and laws as the Lord my God commanded me, so that you may follow them in the land that you're entering to take possession of it." Well, that's a good thing to think about. What are you taking possession of? What does God have as inheritance for you? "Observe them carefully, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, 'Surely this God is a controlling God. He is forcing you to do things. These rules are too hard to follow.'" No, no. What are they going to say? "Surely they will hear about these decrees and say, 'Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.'"
Right.
"What other nation is so great as to have their gods near with them the way the Lord our God is near us whenever we pray to him?" Isn't that amazing? "And what other nation is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of laws I'm setting before you today? We obey because God has a perfect plan." So that old saying, do as I say, not as I do, does not apply to the Christian walk. We need to be people that are aligned with Christ so we can exhort others to follow us, not for our own sake, but for the sake of the kingdom. All right, so that's a pretty big long list, right? So how's this possible? What do we need to do? I'm back to my original question. So what do I need to do? To do all these things, right? All right, so now this is where it gets really fun. I want you to flip over to Colossians chapter 3. Now remember I said we don't work. Holy Spirit works. Our responses, our actions are an outworking of his work in us, all right? So that is the key for us here. I want you to go to Colossians 3. I'm actually going to read through this entire scripture from 1 to 17, and then I'm going to go back and I'm going to point out four responses that we will have if the Holy Spirit is working in us, four responses that will help us to be people that when others encounter us, they'll see these eight things in us or more. I mean, I haven't even gotten to the power of God and all of that. There's other stuff that they will see in us, but of these eight particularly. All right, so Colossians 3, verse 1 to 17. "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways." I love that. You used to walk in these ways.
Yeah.
"In the life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you." Ooh, that's a tall order, hey? "And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." All right, so how is it possible for people to encounter us? Let's pick this apart just a little bit. The very first thing, your response, this is something that you're going to respond, is that you're going to believe that he is the resurrection and the life.
Yeah.
So let's go back to verse 1 to 4. Since then you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Scripture says he's seated there interceding for us. Directly to the Father. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory.
Yeah.
So we have no fear in death. I believe that he is the resurrection and the life. I have no fear of death. One day I will face a physical bodily death. But he faced death for us, he conquered it. And he has a hope and a future for us in eternity.
Yeah.
But there's also no fear in life. We can live abundantly. We have life for today and hope for the future, for eternal life after death, even after my physical body is gone. So our first response, believe he is the resurrection and the life. Our second response is now we need to feed on that life, feed on the bread of life, that's Jesus himself.
Yeah.
So let's go back, this is in verses, the next few verses here. Oh, sorry, it's the same set of scriptures there. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. And I was thinking about a couple of ways. There's lots of ways to feed on him, but I'm going to highlight two. We need to celebrate communion often. And that is a physical representation of how we feed on Christ. And I'm going to refer to Teresa again. She spoke such a beautiful word about what communion really means. It means that we align with him. It means that we remember what he has already accomplished, and we look forward expectantly to what is to come, and we proclaim who he is, and we do that regularly, often. And then the second thing is that you need to read his word. This physical word is the word of God, inspired word of God. You need to feast on it. So I'm going to use some language that the ladies will recognize from our mentoring this year in the book that we read. You need to become Bible literate. So that means you need to read it regularly, consistently. You need to soak in it. Discover the background of it. Find out the context. Why these words were written, who they were written to. What was the setting. All of that is really important for you to deeply understand God's word. You need to find connections. The connections to Christ run from Genesis to Revelation. Do you know the connections? You need to ask him, most importantly, to speak to you and reveal his now word for you, his word for you. These are not old words. These are ancient and beautiful words. But they are now words. They're words for today.
Right.
It's exciting. That's part of the mystery of being found in him, is this word. All right. So that doesn't seem so hard so far, right? Believe that he's the resurrection and the life, and then feed on him. Feed on that life. All right, now we're going to pop down to verse 16. Go all the way to verse 16, and we're going to talk about how we need to follow his lead and do his will. That's our other response. Follow his lead and do his will. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word, so that's what you speak, or indeed what you do, your actions, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks, there's that thanksgiving again, to God the Father through him. So we need to let God's word inhabit our conversations. When we love him, we are in love with him, and we're soaking in his word, we're feasting on him, we know he is the resurrection and the life, we can't help but have him part of our conversations. And then this is a very interesting word. Did you notice this little note here that said, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. Isn't that an interesting word, that admonish? So in the world's definition of admonish, it means like a sharp rebuke, a reprimand. But in the biblical sense, it has a beautiful, beautiful meaning. It actually means to indicate duties or obligations, and it means to express warning or disapproval, but get this, in a gentle, earnest, solicitous manner. See, God's way of doing things is always different than the world's. In the world, you'll be admonished, you'll be rebuked, you'll be reprimanded. But us as believers, we gently help, we warn, we correct, but we do it with gentleness and earnestness. And it also means to give friendly, earnest advice or encouragement. So you're admonishing when you're encouraging your friends. You're admonishing when you're saying, you're going down a path that is not going to lead you to God's best for you. But we do it with gentleness, because gentleness is a sign that God is near. Yeah, it's pretty neat. Pretty neat stuff. All right, then, there's this whole section here. I have to go and delve into this a little bit, but about worship. We worship corporately. We worship intimately and individually as well. Don't you love this part where it says, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Do you know what that means? The Holy Spirit is waiting to be a composer in you. He wants to write a specific song that you worship to him. That's how intimate he is with us. That intimacy of composing that response. So even in our response, he's helping us with our response. It's not even up to us, it's his work. So neat. And then there's that thing about being grateful consistently, and whatever you do, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, because your primary motivation is to respond to his work in you at all times. All right, so this is sounding like we can do this, right? We can do this stuff? Yes? Okay, good, excellent. All right, our last one is probably the hardest one. The last response is to abide in him. And this speaks to holy living, and this is always hard. This is a hard one. There's that little word abide means to remain, to stay, to be faithful, to be continually present. Isn't that a neat meaning? And to make the most of every opportunity. So if you pop back to verses 8 to 10, verse 5, starting verse 5, where it says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. I'm not going to read through that again, but I ask you, I submit to you in a gentle way to go back and sit with God and just say, God, I'm going to read through this. Can you reveal to me what are the things that I am not living holy before you? What things need to be rooted out? A healthy fear of our Lord is such a strong motivator to walk in holiness, because he is a holy and righteous God. So when we have a life-changing understanding, a personal revelation of God's holiness and his purity and his perfection, we will stand in awe of him. And that reverence motivates us to follow his commandments, those commandments that make us wise in the sight of everyone around us. I have a friend who got saved years ago out of that kind of hippie era. So, you know, free love, the drugs, all of that kind of stuff. And God did an amazing transformative work in her life. And she said that she's still the same friend, so she went to a bar to hang out with her friends, because that's where her friends hung out. And she went to light up a cigarette, and she had such an instant distaste for that thing. She couldn't even put it to her lips. And from that moment on, she never touched another cigarette. So sometimes God will do something in us that is an immediate transformation, and root out something immediately. But we do not serve a silver bullet. We serve a refining God. And so more often, he will work things out of us, and it's hard work, and it hurts sometimes, and we have to work hard to get rid of stuff and take it back to him continually and say, God, help me with this. But to respond to the Holy Spirit always brings life, and life more abundantly. It is worth the fight. So if you're working against something in your nature that goes against anything in this list or more, Take it back to Jesus. Take it to the cross.
Yeah.
Be grateful for what he's done. Align yourself with what he's doing in you. And look forward to the good that's coming. Did you get all four of my points?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Awesome. So that's just our responses are. Oh, I'm on the wrong page. Believe that he's the resurrection and the life. Feed on that bread of life, Jesus. Follow his lead and do his will. And then abide in him, in that holy living. I want to read you a psalm, just a bit of a psalm from Psalm 25. This is verse 4 and 5. It says, show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior. And my hope is in you all day long. I love that God has orchestrated this entire service to be focused on him and his hope. He is our hope. God's truth is certainty. It is stability. It is rightness and trustworthiness. And it is something upon which you can stake your life. And this scripture also speaks to the intimacy of how we learn that truth. Remember at the beginning I said that God does the work? Look what the psalmist has done. He's put all the work back on God's shoulders. Show me your ways, Lord. Who's doing the showing? The Lord, right? Teach me your paths. Who's doing the teaching? The Lord. Guide me in your truth. Who's doing the guiding? The Lord, right? Teach me, for you are God, my Savior. Who's doing the saving?
The Lord.
The Lord. Yes, that's right. And then, who does the hoping? My hope is in you.
Yeah.
He does all the work. We respond. Okay, so what's going to be the result? People are going to encounter us. This is very exciting. This is the best part. If we respond to the Holy Spirit's work in us, we are going to grow and mature.
Yes.
And our growth and our maturity is measured not by our independence, but by our dependence on him. The world says you need to get more and more independent. Don't rely on anybody else, anything else. Be your own God. In Christ's economy, our maturity is measured by our dependence on him. And the second thing that's going to happen is there's going to be productivity in the kingdom. Now, that productivity is also not measured the same way as the world does. The world measures by what have you accomplished? What have you done? What have you made yourself to be? But productivity in the kingdom is measured by how others encounter Christ in us. How have we responded to the work that he's done? So Christ accomplishes the work. We simply draw others to him by our lives and how we respond. So we come full circle all the way back to what I said in the beginning. How do others encounter Christ when they brush up against us? We respond to that transformative work that he started in us, and our actions reveal Christ's nature, and we draw others to him. So we speak often to scripture that says it is the kindness of God that draws man to repentance. Just pray, oh God, let us be the conveyors of your kindness. Draw others to yourself as they brush up against us. So, you don't have to stress. You don't have to do or be anything. Just respond to his work inside you, what he's calling you to be. I want to just finish with a reading. This is from the Passion Translation. But just listen to the beautiful things that God has already given to you, what he's done for you. This is 1 Corinthians 4, verses 4 to 9. In him you have been made extravagantly rich in every way. You have been endowed with a wealth of divine inspired utterance and the riches that come from your intimate knowledge of him. For the reality of the truth of Christ is seen among you and strengthened through your experience of him. So now you aren't lacking any spiritual gifts as you eagerly await the unveiling of the Lord Jesus, the Anointed One. He will keep you steady and strong to the very end, making your character mature, so that you will be found innocent on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So going back in here, after that hard work of holy living, go back to verse 12 in Colossians there. It says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, Bear with each other and forgive one another. And if any one of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Isn't that a description of our Jesus?
Yeah.
And that's who we want to be like. We want to show him to the world. I'm going to end off this reading from 1 Corinthians. God is forever faithful, and he can be trusted to do this in you. Who's doing the doing? For he has invited you to co-share in the life of his son, Jesus, the anointed one, our King. God, I want to thank you for your word today. I want to thank you for the fact that you've revealed things about life in a chaotic world. We know that you are the resurrection of life. Mm-hmm. We just thank you, God. We thank you that you have invited us to co-share with you in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ. So we're going to actually pray a prayer together today. And maybe you're praying this prayer for the first time. Maybe you've never accepted that invitation to co-share this life. But if the Holy Spirit's been working in you and saying to you, well, there's something in this. I need peace. I need a Savior. I need someone to be grateful to. I need to know who's in control. Well, Christ died for your sins. He died so that we could be redeemed. So we're going to pray a prayer together. And I want you to, if it's your first time, you can pray this. It's as simple as saying, God, I believe who you say you are. Please start a work in me. And maybe you're going to pray this because you want to, kind of reassert or affirm that you believe he is the resurrection and the life. And that you want him to continue to do a work in you. You want to abide in him. You want to clothe yourself with him so that others can encounter Christ through you. So let's pray together. God, I just come today and I tell you that I believe in you. I believe in you, God. I believe that you are the resurrection and the life. I want you to start a work in me today, God. Give me the desire to read your word, to learn more of you, to get to know who you are. I invite your Holy Spirit to come into my heart, into my soul, and to do a work that only you can do. And then, God, I ask you, help me to know how to respond. Help me to know which of those doors I should open, God, to make good choices, to live a holy life, to clothe myself in your personality, your character traits, your attributes, God, so that others are drawn closer to you by kindness and gentleness. And then, God, help me not to walk in arrogance, because there's nothing to boast in here. Nothing to boast in of me, myself, God. You are in all and through all. You are the only one we can go to for wisdom. But God, help me to walk in power and authority, because all power and authority belongs to you. So thank you, God. Come into my heart. Become part of my life. And I will respond to you. We love you, God. Amen. So if there's anybody who needs prayer today, Derek and I are here, Tammy and Jesse, but we're all prayers here. Find someone to pray with you and to encourage you. And go with God today, knowing that every encounter you have with anyone is their encounter with a living hope.
Yeah.
Let that just sink in today for you guys. Thank you guys. Have a great week.
Yeah.